Thank you so much, Kanika and Asha. And I feel privileged to be the moderator of the panel today. And I don't know about you guys, but I am very excited for today. So without any further ado, let's welcome our speakers for today. First, we are honored to have amongst us the core member of PD Green's Innovation Private Limited, Ms. Manisha Jani. Mrs. Jani looks after the compliance and social impact measurement. Her target groups remain in rural and slum communities, including but not limited to MSMEs, SHGs, and federations, farmer produce organizations, and most importantly, youth. She is constantly working to introduce new SHGs so that employment can be increased for traditional local communities. Ma'am, we are privileged to have you with us today. Thank you so much. Our next speaker for the day is Ms. Saloni Sajeti, founder Bansuri. Bansuri, Bamboo Artisan Socio-Economic Upliftment Initiative, started by Ms. Saloni. Ms. Saloni completed her graduation from Delhi University and her LLB from Banaras Hindu University. Afterwards, she joined the SBI India Youth Fellowship Program, where she stayed in the districts of Dang for 30 months. This is where she had her great child, Bansuri. Ma'am has won several awards. Ms. Saloni has won Best Startup Award under Sustainable Livelihood category by Ministry of Rural Development and NIIB Hyderabad in 2019. She also won 3 MCII Young Innovative Challenge Award under Rural category in 2018 and was also one of the top 18 social innovators at NSCI PIC in 2018. We are blessed to have you with us, ma'am. And more importantly, ma'am loves to meet new people. And she's a keen learner. And with her passion to do something for the community, ma'am has had the courage to break the stereotypical rules and also bring change in her field of career. She's a commendable human being, and it is our pleasure to be with you, ma'am. Our next speaker for the day, Mr. Manan Nizar. He will be joining us virtually. Mr. Manan is a veteran innovator and an AU current technologist. His experience in mechanics and electronics is undeniable, and he has worked in several innovative technologies in a lot of domains. Sir is the CEO and co-founder of Buildover Technologies, a company which raised pre-revenue round up at $1 million valuation of the company. Mr. Manan has several awards and recognitions under his name, including but not limited to with the top 10 student entrepreneurs at Global Student Entrepreneurship Award in 2016. The following year, he won at the Startup League and also at the Business Ventures Social Direct Accessible India and the Mohan Hill Bio Business at IIT Kanpur. In 2018, Sir represented India in Tourism Israel for Start JNN in 2018 and was also the winner of the Idea Day organized by Kerala Startup Mission and initiated by the government of Kerala. Sir is a talented human being, and we are blessed to have you with us, sir.
Thank you.
So, I have always understood by Aladi that the right words at the right time can open the world of treasure. So let's now start in the right conversation with the right people here and now, and dive deep in the treasure of knowledge and wisdom. With this, I would like to begin our talk. My first question for all of you today would be, so most basic of the question, so that everyone can know what we are talking about. Can you please tell all of us that what you all do? Let's start with Manisha.
I am Manisha Jani, and I have been working as an advisor to IndiGreen's Innovations Private Limited, one of the promoters for the organization that put up the task to look at how to bring about self-reliance for women groups particularly, and conserving the traditional production processes, and also to look at how poverty can be eliminated by creating rural employment, giving them opportunities which they not have had for a very, very long time in a systematic manner. So the ethos of the organization was to build capacities of these women so that they can compete with the best of products that's needed in the urban as well as the global markets. Whereas right now, if we see the rural products, how they are getting manufactured is a big question mark. So when a product comes to a shelf, we are very worried about what kind of compliances does it need. Is it good for my health? Is it made in the right way? Does it have the right nutritional value? These are some of the questions that have been posed after coronavirus has taken up in our economy further more than they were done before. So, having seen the challenges that indigenous products find in meeting the market demand, we thought that there is a big gap. It was essential to understand what the government is supporting these groups with currently and over the years, to see how to bridge the gap that they are facing right now, to take advantage of the various schemes and promotions, incentives of the government that are available to private enterprises, and then make those steps happen for the women to come together to make the right kind of product which the consumers are demanding. I think our addressal of the gaps was what was, I think, the story that we wanted to build for taking up the organization forward. So our perspective was to build for the local what was missing, and then giving them a voice that here we are, we have the traditional knowledge and we are able to bridge the path and meet the market demand. So we take big pride, as Father said, that till the time we take ownership for what we know is right, and we want it to be promoted so that we are able to do away with the poverty gap that we have currently for people to progress. I think that was the mission of thinking how to grow the organization. I would stop there for you to take on.
That was indeed a very noble initiative, and I'm pretty much sure that every one of us can learn something from this experience. Selina, can you begin, please?
Hi, thank you so much for the lovely introduction. Respected Father Rex and Worky and all the organizing team. My name is Saludi Sashiti, is already said by Tanish. I'm a lawyer turned social entrepreneur. I did my law from Banaras Hindu University, and suddenly a striking point came in my life and I started working with the tribals. So I directly come to the point what we do and how we do. So we work with a tribal group of people in Gujarat. There's a place called Dangs in Gujarat, one of the most economically distressed districts, and 90% of the population is tribal. So I will go for a bilingual. Is that all the people are comfortable with bilingual, right? So I will go with the bilingual thing. So 90% of the population is tribal. Major source of income is agriculture. But problem is that after monsoon there is no water. So there is no livelihood there in Dangs. So but the beautiful part about Dangs is that a lot of bamboo in it. So when I went there, I really saw the poverty-ridden area. People were sleeping on the floor. They were not having a proper meals. There was no concept of actually regular income in their lives. जब तक पैसा है, जब तक ठीक है, but suddenly जिस दिन पैसा खत्म हो गया, then they start working. So that is the problem we are facing. जो UN के goals, the SDG goals, जिसमें poverty eradication है. So this is one of the factor. So हमें सोचा कि let's do something with bamboo because bamboo से already बहुत सारी products वहाँ पे बनाए जा रहे थे. But ये चीज हम local vocal for local बहुत easily कह देते हैं. But जब वो खरीदने पर आती है ना वो बात, तो पीपल ट्राई टू नेगोशिएट अलॉन्ग. ठीक है, अगर वही रूलर एक इंसान, ट्राइबल इंसान जमीन पे बैठ के आपको वो सामान बेच रहा होगा ना, वो 10 रुपए का अगर प्रोडक्ट होगा, यू विल ट्राई टू आज उसको 5 रुपए में दे दो, राइट? सो दिस इज, हम तारीफें बहुत कर देंगे कि दिस इज सो प्रिटी, बट खरीदने पर हम यही रुक जाते हैं. So we started working on it, and after analyzing and seeing, we thought of making contemporary bamboo jewelry. And apparently, we are India's only one who is making contemporary bamboo jewelry right now. So right now with us, we have 15 artisans on board. Five are precisely for jewelry, and 10 are for home decor and all. We have recently introduced our home decor during COVID time. So yeah, apparently we do this.
That's really beautiful, man. And of course, working with the tribal people, getting to know the culture is a complete different experience, especially nowadays, as all of us are not, you know, tied up in the city experience. Now we would like to ask the same question to Manan, sir.
Sure. Am I audible?
So, sir, can you speak up for a moment so that we can calibrate?
Sure. Am I audible? Like, I'll just change the mic. Yeah. Is this better now?
On it.
Hello. Hello.
Perfectly audible बोल रहे हैं शब्द।
तनिष्क।
All right.
We can't hear you here.
Sir, we can't really hear you here. This side.
All right. I think like on Zoom, it's.
Give us 2 minutes.
Sure. Sure. No problem. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
चालू है।
माइक चालू।
ये ले लो।
नहीं पता ऑडियो वहाँ तो
लगा
रहा
हूँ
Yeah.
No. Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Speak on your ears.
Even looks so.
It's good work. इसका audio चालू करूँ क्या मैं? एक second. इसका
One second.
That's all right.
Audio off, sir.
All right. First of all, thank you so much for inviting me here. I think it's a brilliant topic to be talked about, and I think a lot of the previous speakers have already given it a really good head start, talking about different parts of the whole topic, talking about how it should be more inclusive, and also how we should not forget the roots, and also look forward towards globalization. So I think it's a brilliant start and a brilliant topic to talk about. About me, I'm currently heading Piltover Technologies, where we are an organization which believes in inclusivity in its core. We develop technologies in the differently abled sector. We've started off by developing prosthetic hands for the people who don't have upper limbs. So we started off by developing a mechanical prosthetic hand because we realized that the current situation is not really suitable for people who belong to the lower economic strata. And the prosthetic hands and the artificial limbs that are given to these people are merely cosmetic. So we wanted to develop products which basically increase the quality of life of these people and develop functional prosthetics at the cost of the cosmetic hands that are given out today. So over the past 3.5 years, we have developed over 140 different prototypes. And today we have the product IDA, which is the world's most functional mechanical prosthetic hand. Together with a lot of different state governments, we are trying to push the product into the market and empower the people at the bottom of the pyramid with this particular product.
That's amazing. And of course, being the functional, the most important thing is functional prosthetics. Because at the end of the day, what you are doing is using not the cosmetic part of it, but part of your body. So that's really amazing, sir.
Thank you.
Now you mentioned something about making of the product. But you mentioned that selling it is hard. Which strikes me as a question that, of course, making of the product is nothing. But at the end of the day, being able to sell it is completely hard. So could you please tell us about the challenges you face in marketing the products you make?
So Tanish, basically what happens, no? When you make a product, you first have to validate it, right? So it's very difficult to validate in any of the areas. So first you validate your community, your surrounding, your family. And then, so our first validation was at Dastakar. There's a very famous exhibition center in Delhi. We apparently got a free stall there because we wrote a letter to them that we are actually working with the tribals and we are improving their livelihood. So we went there to validate our product. So जब हमने वहाँ पे exhibition लगाई the first day we got a mixed response. We people were coming to us, people were like, okay, it's a nice thing. But when we started explaining the story behind the product and what we do and how we make it, so we got the same thing कि आपको सिर्फ ना product नहीं बेचना है. You have to tell the story along with your product, right? So we started telling that these are made by the tribals and they face a lot of problems and why we use it. And so our product has has three USPs. One is finish, one is durability, and one is contemporaneous. Okay. So lightweight, because bamboo hai to apne aap lightweight ho jata hai. So when we started telling these people about this, the quality of ki hamare medium mein aisa hai, so people started liking it and they started buying it from us. So wahin par hi hamara sabse pehla bulk order aaya tha. We were expecting ki haan theek hai validate karne aaya hai, we were not expecting ki hamara products ekdam se bulk order aa jaye. But the bulk order was around 60k that time jab hum validation ke liye gaye the, and exhibition mein we made a sales of around 70k. So बाहर से हमारी मार्केटिंग की शुरुआत हुई. We got an idea कि यहाँ पे selling होते souvenir shops, nature shops, जो hotels में छोटे souvenir shops होते हैं वहाँ पर. And that's how we started marketing our product. We started going to the places जहाँ पे ऐसी shops होती हैं. So जैसे कि we do it to Garvi Gujodi in Gujarat. So that's how we started doing marketing. But obviously COVID के time में we did a lot of B2C. ये हमारा जो major function था, that was B2B. But during COVID time, we started B2C and became more active on Instagram and Facebook.
That's really amazing. And you are right, the story says, because after knowing the story completely, when I got to know the numbers, I personally was really happy that you got it. You are right, the story says. Ma, I have a question for you. The work that your company does can actually be done not just for India but abroad also. So what is that one thing that made you stay in India and work for our country instead of settling or having headquarters out?
So the plan was to give the company a culture built on the ethos that here are women, like women who want to sell indigenous products. So right from creating livelihoods through achars, rabas, the, you know, the turmeric pickles, and different types of immunity boosting, you know, which is more recognized and is a part of our palate in Indian cuisine. This forms a very, very integral part. So we wanted to capitalize on one front by enabling these women to come up with the local recipes. That was one. So culture was to be conserved. Second was to look at how to build, you know, innovation. So while there is a bigger community of veganism which is coming up, and in India it's also picking up. So why have international products come in where we are the ones who are growing these nuts? We have the best of almonds. We have the best of pistachios, cashews from the country. So we got into making of these peanut butters and all of the nut butter range, which is doing phenomenally well online. So the idea was to come up with an innovativeness and at the same time give a touch of the Indian flavors. So the two were a great blend to begin with. Nevertheless, looking at grains which have high nutritional value, looking at spices which can go into our food products and build immunity, I think those are the next line of items which there is a lot of research that's going on. But for now, the establishment and giving these women continuous work is the primary force that we're working on.
Because especially as Lokesh mentioned, that it's not just about the products. Local is our culture, local is our language, local is everything that's in you. And I think we all need to understand this. When I was reading your introduction and I was meeting everything, I realized one thing, that you have so many accomplishments in terms of the awards. You must have gotten a lot of, offers from companies. What made you not take up on these offers and start your own business? Because of course, having a startup in India, as we know, the numbers of success is very low.
Right.
So what made you take this huge step? What was the point?
I think when we talk about the percentage of startups which are not really successful, my personal outlook on that is directly proportional to the persistence and the hard work that you put in. I feel like if you have a basic idea about what you really want to do, and you've put in enough thoughts on it, and you totally understand what you want to achieve over the journey that you have for that particular startup, it basically boils down to the amount of time and efforts that you put towards that particular idea to make it a success. So for me, I think when it comes to my personal life, I always wanted to develop technology and have impact associated with it. So working in Piltover, I think that's something which satisfied my mind as well, on an everyday basis, where we are going out trying to do new things, innovating newer mechanisms, all to try to have an impact on lives of people. So I think that has been the driving force, and has been something that has always motivated us, not just me, actually, my team as well, a group of wonderful people, working towards the same vision, trying to have an impact. So I think that has been the basic motivation towards doing whatever we are doing today.
And then you don't have to work a day in your life. So that's it. So the other question is that I feel that what do you feel that for the locals of our country are lacking, which is distinctly their role? And according to you, what they can do to overcome the law?
Absolutely. I think the chief guest initially had talked about how we should not have a very closed mindset about things, and also talked about the kind of education that is imparted in institutes as well. I think institutes in India set up a really good base, considering if you take up a random person from India and a person from US, for example, both people who have undergone education, the kind of knowledge that they have, talking about a particular subject, stereotypes are again based on that. Talking about math, for example, is something that in India students are made to practice so much that they don't even need calculators for basic calculations. So I think the quality of education is definitely there in India. The kind of direction in which that's headed is amazing as well. However, when it comes to adapting to newer technologies or newer discoveries that are happening in the globe, I think that's somewhere where India definitely needs to open up a little bit more. For example, in our organization itself, we are using 3D printing technology to be able to manufacture the products. So if you look back in the history of 3D printing, 2008, around 2008 is when the patent got opened up. 2012, I had the opportunity to work in the field of 3D printing. And it's 2020, 21, and people now know about 3D printing. But again, if you talk about an average mechanical engineer graduating from an Indian institute, they probably haven't had hands-on work on a 3D printer. So I think adapting to newer technologies, adapting to the trends that are actually growing, and not just talking about it. I mean, 2021, again, we're talking about machine learning, artificial intelligence, but we are just touching the bases of those. I think people need to dive in, only from the educational perspective as well, but from an individual initiative needs to be taken as well in order to learn and master that particular domain to be able to be relevant in today's market. I mean, not only do it for the relevance, but also if they really want to do something in their lives, would be definitely useful. So I think that's one conscious decision that a person can take, where they try to keep themselves updated not to everything in the world, like social media, I think like already does that for us, but to be more specific and like targeted towards what one individual wants to achieve in their own lives.
I'd like to add a point to it. I think what works in terms of economics is also to build the value chain of the actors in such a fashion that you synergize what they're doing. So not one group of people can do everything. Let's accept their expertise that are involved. And respecting that and working towards building economics to the model so that when it reaches to the end market, you're not making it uncompetitive. So our effort should be on synergizing each of the actors that are there in the supply chain, be it crafts, be it food industry, or be it any product for that matter. Till the time you're able to capacitate each of the actors, synergize them, and then enable the market actors to accept it, I think that's the key to building the market for them.
That's very true, Mara, because without synergizing everything, there will always be one component value. And it won't be a proper circle and the market.
I certainly agree to the point ma'am said, because see, I said it in the very sense ki matlab skilled laborers hain, these are all trained artisans, right? If I talk about the artisans precisely, so when they sell their product, we try to weaken more the weaker section, right? So apparently jo actors hain, person who's helping them should actually synergize supply chain activity. So अगर आप एक प्रोडक्ट बनाते हैं, राइट, सो यू हैव टू सेल हाउ इट इज बीइंग मेड, अदरवाइज वो एक नॉर्मल प्रोडक्ट की तरह ही लोग खरीदेंगे. दिस आर अलॉट ऑफ प्रोडक्ट्स, अ टी-शर्ट, बहुत तरह की टी-शर्ट, बट एक बाबू खादी की टी-शर्ट हैज अ डिफरेंट व्यू, राइट? सो यू हैव टू मेक पीपल अवेयर ऑफ द प्रोडक्ट्स यू आर सेलिंग. सो इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कि प्रोडक्ट बनने के बाद में लोगों के पास पहुंचने तक भी उसके बारे में लोगों को उस चीज का पता. Society in the community. It's very true, even in, not in rural area, in the urban sector also, it's very hard to sustain individually. It's always better to work in a team or in a cooperative or in SSGs. So there's an altogether different formula how you work with SSGs, how you work with cooperatives, right? So there's no rocket science in that, people actually enjoy working in group, and it's always a teamwork which actually grows. It's not an individual thing, never an individual thing.
I feel that there is a very, very important need of the hour to enable these SHGs to grow beyond what they're doing. So they're just making and throwing it into the markets. They don't know where it's going. They don't know what's happening to the end product, because they're only limited to what the next person is giving them. Instead, if we collectivize these self-help groups, if we collectivize them and enable them, institutionalize them, जैसे कि हमारे कई सारे गवर्नमेंट के प्रोग्राम्स हैं, RGABP टू मेन वन, राजस्थान ग्रामीण आजीविका विकास प्रोग्राम जो है, वो ऐसे समूहों को नेक्स्ट लेवल पे फेडरेट करता है. फेडरेट करने के बाद भी वो चाहता है कि ये खुद से अपना मार्केट ढूंढे, पर ये ब्रिज करना जहाँ पे गवर्नमेंट की सहायता है, लेकिन उनको वो राइट इनपुट्स नहीं मिल पाते जो कि मार्केट सीख कर रहा है. मार्केट का ये अदर वांट्स कि आप
काम करिए और स्टैंडर्डाइज तरीके से काम कीजिए. तो ये जो दो चीजों की तालमेल कि हम सही प्रोडक्ट बनाए और दूसरी तरफ मार्केट बल्क में मांग रहा है, इस चीज को ब्रिज करने के लिए सिर्फ और सिर्फ इंस्टीट्यूशनलाइज और कोई ना कोई ऐसी टेक्निकल एजेंसी चाहिए जो कि इसको एनेबल कर सके कि वो प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी की तरफ काम करे बजाय कि इंडिविजुअली अपना बनाए और बेचे. तो कलेक्टिवाइजेशन इज द मंत्र फॉर मेकिंग द बल्क मार्केट अकॉर्डिंग टू मी.
बट लाइक यू मेंशन स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन इज राइट, बट लाइक डोंट यू थिंक दैट स्टैंडर्डाइजेशन एंड आर्टिज़न नेवर एनी गो हैंड इन हैंड, बिकॉज़ आई बिलीव दैट इवन इन द कोऑपरेटिव सेटअप राइट नाउ लाइक इवन एवरी रूटीन आर्टिस्ट वुड मेक समथिंग डिफरेंट विद देयर ज्वेलरी. Even if you are eligible to make the exact same product.
Yeah, I think that varies for food products and for crafts. I'm a firm believer that if a craft is identical or it got standardized, then it loses its beauty. So there is a constant evolvement to have almost similar thing, but the consumer appreciates that there is a difference when they know that it is handmade. The moment it becomes a machine made, the standardization appears and acceptance of it comes from the point where the consumer doesn't know what is authentic handmade and what is not. Whereas in food, we are constantly looking at the same taste, be it for papad, be it for achar, be it for any other product. So standardization is required with the due compliances for food products. That's a given. It cannot be compromised upon it.
So the next question is, you will open for all of them. Do you like any of you had a recent time, especially after the vocal for local slogan got so trending, that there has been a cultural shift and people are actually demanding more Indian products against their foreign counterparts? Has anyone of you witnessed this in your particular level?
Yes, I do. But I think there is no need just to propaganda banaya gaya tha. I think it should come from the within. इसको बनाया गया बट दैट्स अ गुड थिंग. बट बिकॉज एज आई सेड अर्लियर वी वर डूइंग अ लॉट ऑफ बी2बी, बट बिकॉज कोविड वाज गोइंग ऑन जब हम बी2बी करते थे वी वर हैविंग अ लिमिटेड अमाउंट ऑफ बी2सी थ्रू इंस्टाग्राम एंड फेसबुक. बट जब कोविड आया वी वर गॉट रियली नाइस रिस्पॉन्स टू इंस्टाग्राम एंड फेसबुक पेज. एंड जो पहले ऑर्डर हार्डली दिन के 5 या 6 ऑर्डर आते थे ड्यूरिंग नॉर्मल टाइम्स, COVID times it rose to around 100 orders in a day or in a month. Yeah, so it was a good way of actually shifting to actually propagate it in a way that people actually started doing more and started more of locals. And yeah, it was a shift for the people. It was.
So, Manan sir, I believe that you actually mentioned that the target audience are especially able people, right?
Right.
So has there ever been an incident or you have a heartwarming story to share with us when your technology literally changed someone else's life?
Absolutely. Like when you ask me that question, I can think of like one particular incident, like which actually changed the way that we looked at things as well. I think initially when we started off, like we weren't, I think like again, this was something that this, like one of the speakers before had talked about, like where the background of a particular person is not really important into like what they're doing. And like same was the case for us. We had like literally no idea about like prosthetics as an industry. It was just an opportunity that we saw and like we were asked to work towards. So for us, it was the same, like we were asked to develop a prosthetic hand and we started working towards it. Initially, not even like being sure about the meaning of the term prosthetic. I remember like Googling it for the first time, like when we were asked to do it, like to be sure that like I'm thinking in the right direction. So I think like one particular incident, like where while we were developing the prototypes of the hand, a particular organization asked us to like come and present, like showcase the progress that we had made. And me and a couple of my teammates like went to that organization and like we demonstrated like the way that the hand would function. Like we, in our product, like we wanted to have like functional elements, like functioning fingers, wrist rotation, thumb rotation. So when we were there, we were trying to like demonstrate all of that. And suddenly, and like there were like big cameras everywhere. And we were like, okay, we just need to like showcase the features. And like, that's it, that's about it. But in that instant, like they called a patient there and they asked us to put the hand onto the patient and like actually like do things with it. And we were not really prepared for that kind of a demo, honestly, at that particular point of time. But then like going back to the days when we were developing, I remember like having late night discussions with my designing team as well, where we were thinking about, okay, like at what particular part of the hand should we place this particular feature so that it's easier for the person to use that particular product. And like on the day of that demo, the person like literally put the hand and within the next 5 seconds, he was holding a glass of water and drinking water by himself. So I think like that really gave us that boost where we were like, okay, we're like having that initial thoughtfulness where we are trying to put ourselves in the shoes of the person like who's actually going to be using the product really, really helps. And it's not just like a cliched sentence that every entrepreneur out there like throws out in the air. So that was definitely something that really helped us. And I remember like when like until that point, I mean, like personally for me, it was something like a technological task that I was trying to achieve, like creating products for the people. But at that particular point in time, like when we were leaving that day, that particular person asked us to ask us like if he could keep that particular hand with him. So I think that is when the emotional part also like struck in, and we were like, okay, like we are actually trying to impact lives to a deeper level. And that's, I think, when it like just quadrupled for us, like the motivation and the efforts that we were putting in order to add more features and like make it more usable for the user. So I think, yeah, that's like one story that comes to my mind, like when you asked me that question.
That's really beautiful. And I can't even believe to imagine how magical the moment would have been. The person that got their last result ad. I mean, he asked me at the end and he could keep that.
Right.
India's huge base is agriculture. So I think maximum economy would be impacted with the food industry if we were able to put streamlined efforts in processing it, making it a value chain and enabling the actors who are there to market the products that they can home grow and home value add. Having said that, I feel we are a very rich country in handicrafts too. None of the other countries would make as varied products that we, especially in Rajasthan, boast of. So if we plan and we grow our clusters in a systematic manner, I feel there is a lot of scope we can do with handicrafts too. So right from minimalistic value add to heavy intricate embroideries or work related to techniques involved in whatever craft form, we should be able to generate huge revenues for our country. We have the example of China before us, where swept our Indian markets with having a Ganesha molded and supplied to our country. Why can't we put the same thing together with minimalist effort using natural resources which we are abundant with in our country? I think we can make the change. We can make it in such a way that we are able to meet the larger markets, larger quantities. I think that would change both the craft as well as the food sector.
Okay. So that's true, man, because of course without the cluster development and knowing our own strength, we won't be able to expand as an economy until we actually start paying for our own strength and start working on them more and more. Now, Saloni ma'am, can you tell us that how do you believe that everyone can start to work if they want to as with the tribal leader? Because I believe the acceptance is always the problem, because they don't accept an outsider to help them with the work that they have been doing for generations. It's a very big task. So how would you like to proceed with that? How would you like to continue with that?
So when I actually went to dance, so it was very difficult to actually collect all the tribal people to listen to the problem they are actually facing. It's very hard to actually tell them you are having a problem and you have to solve that, right? So when I went there, so people were eagerly to come and visit me, because see, it was there, bhai se bakri madam sahab aayi hai, you have to come. And but you know, they want to gather, listen, and then go back. But they won't realize the problem and try to solve it. So when I went there, I actually spoke for around 2 hours with the community. It was 100 people meeting there. So I asked them, I told them ki aapko jo kaam kar rahe, it's not very correct. Jis tarike ka aapka procedure chal raha hai, ki you are not interested in regular source of income. You are just working with Mandreka or college bana diye, roads bana diye, agriculture ho gaya. You need to think about education. You need to think about your room because they were having no pakka houses. They were sleeping on the floors and all. So when I went there, so I actually asked them ki aapko sochna padega apne bachon ke bare mein padhai ke. And after 2 hours of speech, actually I got 10 artisans. उन्होंने बोला कि रियली वी वांट टू वर्क विद यू बट इट्स नॉट ऐसा नहीं कि वो मोटिवेशन सिर्फ उसी टाइम तक था टिल नाउ व्हेनेवर आई कॉल माय आर्टिसंस बिकॉज़ ड्यू टू कोविड आई एम नॉट एबल टू गो टू डांस सो व्हेनेवर आई कॉल सो आई एक्चुअली मोटिवेट देम कि भी आपको नए डिजाइन बनाने पड़ेंगे आपको उस तरीके से काम करना पड़ेगा सो द मोटिवेशन कीप्स ऑन ग्रोइंग इट्स वेरी हार्ड टू मोटिवेट द ट्राइबल्स बिकॉज़ गेटिंग देम ऑन बोर्ड and making them understand the problem and finding a solution is apparently very difficult but I'm happy that apart from 100 from those 100 people at least 50 or 10 people can get affected from this and can come to board and work with us
that's really amazing and I believe that some of us might actually go to a rural area tribal area and we'd be able to replicate what you would have done in the district of that so Manak sir What do you think is the major problem with the current policies of India, like which is prohibiting the growth of the upper domestic sector?
Sorry, I couldn't hear you properly. Can you repeat?
Yeah, I'm saying that what do you think is the major problem with the current policies of India, which is prohibiting the growth of our domestic sector?
I think like first of all like I think like it's a general instinct like where we try to just criticize the government on everything that they're doing like I've been there myself but like as like I've like proceeded with the like organization I think I've come across a lot of opportunities that are there too so definitely like before I like talk about the problems that are there I'd like want to mention considering this is a student platform like a lot of like people out there like probably would have ideas too so I just like want to take a moment and like talk about the different kind of opportunities that are out there by different ministries for people like who are trying to do something like if you guys have like a particular idea or a particular problem that you're trying to solve the government has tried to create with this whole startup bubble like the kind of opportunities in which you can fit in and like the government funds you even like supports you to develop those technologies there when it comes to however the part like where you ask like what are the problems that are holding us back I think like one of the major issue definitely is quality like I love the concept of vocal for local like I really admire the whole idea of self sustenance as well however like if like I were to ask like anybody of you like to let's say like not use like any foreign branded like mobile phone today and like go for like an Indian alternative like if we look at the option that we'll have the like amount of like competency like that would be there in terms of the features that a person is getting is not much I think like ma'am mentioned like the whole standardization in the food industry is like a standard it needs to be there and the local part I think like could be like the like cherry on the cake where like it's a brilliant thing that it's like made in India and like India is doing it like by themselves but I think the whole process or like the whole technology or the whole service anything that the person is buying needs to have that kind of a standard so when we say that we should move towards like local products and local services definitely I think like that's a beautiful thought but at the same time we should try to build towards like a scenario where we have competent products and services out there to be able to replace what we have today I again like we talk about let's say like any particular industry when it comes to shifting completely again like clothing brands I think like India has a rich culture there so we have like good alternatives there but again you don't expect people to be wearing let's say a khadi kurta on an everyday basis like going to the office for example so like part of which has been taken and like I mean well inculcated from the like cultures of western countries as well I think it needs to be a perfect amalgamation of the kind of ideas that are there so like in a progressive way having that kind of a mindset but also trying to build like locally if we really want to like accept this notion of like no like I just want to like have products from India or like have it like even like going deeper on the geographical scale locally I think quality is something that like India really needs to like work towards and try to match those standards and give people like a run like the other organizations run for their money when it comes to that.
That is really true, because at the end of the day, as a consumer, we really want quality when we are paying for money.
Absolutely, yeah.
Utility matters. That's really true. So with this, I would like to tell you that Vocal for Local, a slogan aiming to help make India a self-reliant, by supporting local businesses. And even though the particular slogan has been trending for what, like 6 months, I guess now? But I believe it is just an extension of the slogan of the Swadeshi movement, which was started by the founder, the father of our country, Mahatma. And even though that movement was not very successful back then, today, after this discussion and hearing about the tribal people, knowing about the food industry and the cluster development with Manisha Ma, and knowing about the technological advancement our country is having with Mr. Manan sir, I am more than hopeful and optimistic that we are going to do it this time. And of course, we are going to have a lot of challenges, of course. Every one of them did. It's not going to be easy, but these people are the real life manifestation of what will happen when we actually overcome those challenges. That every good thing must end. So, I'm really sorry, but this demonstration must end too. But remember that I believe that there is no end to anything. It's just where we stop the story. And it's just a comma and not a full stop. Because here, we are again going to begin, all of us together, for making our nation a self-reliant one by being vocal about the local. So I extend my heartfelt gratitude towards all our distinguished speakers, Mrs. Manisha Ma, Mr. Loni Ma, and Mr. Madison, for their essential and valuable contribution for the market. And I'm sure that the pearls of wisdom and knowledge that you shared with every one of us today would prove indispensable. Thank you so much, everyone. With this, I can conclude the podcast.